Shabbat Shalom. Welcome back to Kitchen Talk. It's been a while since I did my last video on Prove Me Wrong about the Sabbath, but my family's gone through some tragedies and it's taken us a while to get to a place where I felt I could do another video. So let's get started. Grab yourself a cup of coffee and let's talk. So the question is, what next? You're ready to keep Sabbath, and what next? What do we do? What is Sabbath, and what are the rules? Are there rules? Are there any rules? Let's read. In Genesis 2, 1 through 3, we know that the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the hosts of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all of his work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he rested from all his work which God created and made. Okay, so there's our Sabbath scripture. And since, of course, we went to John in the New Testament and pulled in our last video, that Yeshua, Jesus, was the Word. And the Word was from the beginning, and the Word was made flesh. So it was Jesus who created the Sabbath. It was Jesus who was there in the beginning of all creation. Yeshua.
When does Sabbath begin?
When do you celebrate it? When is the proper time?
God called the light day and the darkness night. There was evening and there was morning one day.
So how does God calculate days? Sabbath begins Friday evening when the sixth day ends and the seventh day begins, and runs all the way through Saturday until Saturday evening when the sun sets. And then you're on the beginning, the end of the seventh day and the beginning of the first day. And it says that that day before the sixth day, that you are to prepare enough food to carry you and your family through the Sabbath. That's Exodus 16, 22, and 23. It happened that on the sixth day, they had gathered twice as much bread, because you have to remember they were eating manna. And so they would gather every morning, and the Lord gave them strict instructions to only gather what their family needed for that day. But he said on the sixth day, gather double portions for you and your family to carry you through the next day.
What Monty and I do is we prepare enough food on preparation day, or the day before Sabbath, and enough to carry us through. So hopefully we don't have to make any more food. You know, now if a whole bunch of people show up and we don't have enough, we might have to throw something in the oven. But to prepare for it, you would prepare enough food to last you through the entire the next
because
day.
Because the theme of this day is rest. So cooking a big meal is not very restful for anyone, whether it's the man doing the cooking or the woman. It's delicious and it's enjoyable, but it's not restful. So do that the day before. No work. Okay. Exodus 20, 8 through 11. He explains during the giving of the Ten Commandments. He tells us, remember the Sabbath day. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. You shall labor 6 days and do all your work, but the seventh day
is a Sabbath to the Lord.
A Sabbath to the Lord. That's so important. This isn't just a gift he gave to you. He established it. This is his day. And he's telling you, this is my Sabbath unto me. As a gift to you, I'm telling you, this is what I want you to do on this day. Okay? Now, as you get deeper into this, and we will in later videos, there's a Sabbath for the land. There's a Sabbath for government and for civil issues.
And those are called Jubilees, Shemitahs. So it's really beautiful. But the theme is no work. You shall not do any work on it, you or your sons or your daughters, your male servant, your female servant, your livestock. So, you know, you can't like say, okay, I'm resting today. It's my Sabbath now. You kids get out there and take out the trash and clean up the yard and whatever. No, 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 no. But you, as a Sabbath keeper, are not to make anybody work on that day. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. It is holy throughout time. From the beginning, He wanted it to be established immediately. So, this is the day of rest. But it's not, it's a rest from work. But that doesn't mean you're just supposed to lounge around on the couch and not do anything, which we had find when we first started keeping it, we found ourselves doing, not truly understanding everything. Was he serious about this? Like, was this like set in stone or whatever? Yes, yes, yes. His warning for breaking the Sabbath is replete through the Bible. When the Israelites broke Sabbath and refused, he called them harlots and profaning his holy day. And there's scripture over and over. You can look those up. Some good resources I'll put in here right now. Some really good resources for helping you download, if you have a computer, the Bible Discovery Program. It's free. And you can download all kinds of versions of scripture, whichever one works for you. And then they also have all of your codexes, the Aleppo Codex, the Leningrad Codex, the Latin Vulgate. All those things are available to you now through this program, and they're free. And that is so extremely helpful. But also, you can use a Hebrew version of the Bible or Greek version of the Bible, and you can copy and paste in Google Translate and find out some of the things that were translated might not have been translated exactly the way we understand them now. Not meaning that they weren't doing a good job translating them, but a lot of the words that they used back then don't have the same meaning now. And so we get a completely different meaning out of something. Anyway, for your study, 119 Ministries, excellent resource. I don't agree with everything that they say, but you're never going to agree completely with anyone. But they are a strong Bible-based, scripture-bound ministry. And I really like New to Torah, N-E-W, the number 2, Torah, T-O-R-A. They have a lot of videos on YouTube, and it's Zach Bauer. Really great guy. He is, and his family came to understand Sabbath and wanted to become Sabbath keepers. And wanted to get back to the Hebrew roots because our Savior was Hebrew, and incorporate the dietary laws into his life. And him and his family are doing it, and they're new to Torah. And so I love his explanation for things. He's a great resource for, you know, new learners, that you come across all this information, and people are sometimes just like so I don't know, stringent and insistent that their way is the way, the only way. Well, we're all new to Torah. We're all trying to figure out how to keep the Sabbath the way Jehovah our God wanted us to, in a way that honors our Lord and our HaMashiach, our Messiah. So there's this balance that has to be made. And in order to do that, you have to search scripture. You have to work these things out. You have to read your word and listen to people who have experienced some things, who have been in the Hebrew roots and Torah movement, and see what they have to say, you know, and weigh everything. Trust no one. If there's anything I've come away from is, it's too easy to sit in a pew and let somebody else feed you what they think, or watch a video like mine and say, oh, well, that makes sense. So yeah, no, be wrong. I can make a video next week and say, oh, y'all, guess what? I've changed my mind about something. It happens. We're new to this. And so we're trying to work this out and figure out what it is we're supposed to be doing to honor the Lord. Out of love, my heart wants to do His will, not mine. Trust me, it would be much easier for me to conform. My family wouldn't think I'm off into some kind of cult. And people wouldn't say, are you Jewish? Well, no, I'm not Jewish. My Messiah was Jewish. My Lord. I'm grafted into Israel. I'm grafted in to this amazing nation and faith that He wanted us to be a part of. And so it's our responsibility to find out what it was He wanted to bless us with. He wanted to bless us with this. He gave it to us and told us over and over. And He was so serious about it. When they didn't keep it, they were punished. When they didn't keep it for the land, for the government, they were punished. They were kicked out of their land. Their temples were destroyed and thrown down. So let's read on. Okay, I don't. All right. So was this a strict rule? Yes, yes, yes. His warning, Leviticus 26, 1 through 35. Now there's many of these. I'm just pulling a few out, you know, to kind of hit the highlights here. You shall keep my Sabbath. And my Sabbath and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord. And He's saying, if you'll follow these laws, your trees will be fruitful. Your vegetables will be plenty. He's saying, this is so important to me. These are established. These are mine. If I'm truly your Lord and I'm your God, then honor me as the Lord. You know, think about the movies you've watched or books you've read in the past about what respect was due a Lord. A Lord was obeyed. His statutes were not questioned. And loyalty to everything He said. So He's saying, let me be your Lord and your God, and you will be my people. Okay? But there's always a but. But if you do not hearken unto me and will not do all these commandments, and if you shall despise my statutes, or if you your soul abhors my judgment, so that you will not do my commandments, but that ye break my covenant, I will also do this unto you. I will even appoint over you terror, consumption, and a burning ague that shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of the heart, and ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. In other words, you're not going to be a free people. You're not going to have all the blessings, and I'm going to send people in, and yeah, you're going to be sowing like you were before, but this time somebody else is going to be reaping the benefits for it. You're not. And ye will not yet, for all this, hearken unto me. I will punish you 7 times more for your sins. And I will make your heaven as iron and your earth as brass. And your strength shall be spent in vain. For your land shall not yield her increase, neither shall the trees yield their fruit. And if ye walk contrary unto me, and will not hearken unto me, I will bring 7 times more plagues upon you. Okay, so there still is people, but He's saying, I've set up dietary laws for you, established a day of rest. I'm giving you these few rules that if you will follow them, your land will be blessed. Because remember in the fall, back in the Eden, not only did Adam fall, but the land was cursed and the garden was closed off. And so He establishes this day of rest and this year of rest, and throughout time for different reasons, for all the things that were cursed during that fall. I'm trying to tell you, as king, as creator of everything, these are the things you need to do. And here are the dietary laws you need to follow in order to be healthy, so that plagues and diseases won't come upon your body, and so that your land will be fruitful, so that your storehouses will be full. In other words, you'll be able to grow your food. You'll be able to eat healthy. He did all of these things because he's saying, I know what's good. I know what's going to happen to it inside your body because I created your body. So follow these. I know when your body needs rest. I know that every single week, every 7 days, you need to sit at my feet and commune with me and love with me and listen to me and read my word, because we forget. And every 7 days we need to fill that bowl again. It doesn't mean we can't do it every day, which I think is a great idea. And it doesn't mean you have to stop going to your church, because you can worship the Lord on any day you want. But don't trick yourself into thinking you're keeping Sabbath or keeping the holy day, because you're not. That's been established in my last video. If you haven't seen it, watch it. But you can still do these things and enjoy your church and your church family. But if you want to keep Sabbath, he's telling you, I have given you those days. These are my days. I established them. If you will keep them, you will be blessed. So there you go. All right, moving on. And your highways shall be desolate. These ways that you thought were so much more wise than the Bible. How many times do you hear people say, oh, that was in the Old Testament. Oh, that was nailed to the cross. My goodness, there are so many things nailed to the cross. It's a wonder there was room for Yeshua up there. I mean, really? Considering he said, I come not to destroy the law, but to fulfill it, to enlighten you about it, to teach you about it. If you knew me, then you know my Father. We're the same, okay? It's kind of like if a father sends his son to his business and wants him to explain some things to them, and he's telling them, you know, this is what my dad wants, and I'm not here to change anything. I'm not trying to tell you I'm the new boss, or, you know, things aren't the way they used to be. I'm just trying to help enlighten you because you're doing it wrong, okay? And so Yeshua kept the Sabbath, and it was important to him to know that he wasn't here to change these things. And as we established in my first video, he was their creation. So it was he who created it. Why would he change it? And when I have broken the staff of your bread, 10 women shall bake your bread in one oven, and they shall deliver you your bread again by weight, and ye shall eat and not be satisfied. Okay. I kind of find that prophetic as to countries that don't follow the established rules for planting, and because we have so many great things now that we can put nutrition back into the earth, man-made nutrition back into the earth, and keep it going past the 7 years. But he was telling us there's an established way to grow things and to do things to keep the nutrients. And he's saying here, when you didn't do these things that I told you, your food got weaker and weaker. They'll bake you 10 loaves and give it to you by weight, and you'll eat all of it and still not be satisfied, because you're not getting the nutrients and the things that you need for your body. As you would if you were to listen to all of his agricultural laws and Sabbaths. Just a side note. And will draw out the sword after you, and your land shall be desolate and your cities waste. Then shall the land enjoy her Sabbaths as long as it lieth desolate. So here he's telling him, you wouldn't keep my Sabbaths. You wouldn't keep the Sabbath for the land. You wouldn't follow my statutes. So I am coming in. I'm sending the enemy, your enemies in, Israel. And the land's going to lie desolate. You're going to be carried away, taken away, and nobody will be there. Well, guess what? Then the land will have a Sabbath. It will rest because you wouldn't give it the rest you were commanded to. I'll give it rest, and it'll be at your expense because of your haughtiness. Okay? And he says, then the land shall rest and enjoy her Sabbath. As long as it lieth desolate, it shall rest, because it did not rest in your Sabbaths when you dwelt in it. I've given you this precious land. A lot of people refer to America as the New Jerusalem, as the new God's new land. Well, guess what? We've only been around for a little over 250 years, and we are number one world power. How did we get there? Were we blessed? Were the original people that came over here keeping Sabbath? Yes, they were. Were they following the agricultural laws? Yes, they were. And we grew and we prospered. And we have no more natural resources than any other country, yet we have flourished in the hands of our Lord. And now we aren't doing that anymore. And not only is it not good enough for us to not follow our agricultural laws, now let's even do something a little bit worse and start manipulating the seed bank that he gave us and GMOs and the DNA of the plants and stuff that he gave us. He gave us rules, and if we aren't going to honor what he's given us and respect it by doing the things he's told us to do, I don't know how long we'll be here. I don't know how long he'll put up with the disobedient and stiff-necked people. Numbers 15, 32 through 41. And while the children of Israel were in the wilderness, they found a man that had gathered sticks on the Sabbath day. Whoa. Now the Lord had just given them his commandments, and he told them, no work on the Sabbath. You are not to work, you're to rest. Okay. The men that found him brought him to Moses and said, what are we going to do about this guy who broke this Sabbath? And he says, all the congregation shall stone him with stones without the camp. That means outside of the camp. And all the congregation brought him outside of the camp, and they stoned him with stones, and he died, as the Lord commanded Moses. So they brought him to Moses, and they said, Moses, what are we going to do? And Moses said, well, I'm not sure. And he went to the Lord, and they put him in the ward, and because it was not declared what they should have done. And the Lord said to Moses, this man shall surely be put to death. Now, he didn't say, you put him to death. He said, he surely shall be put to death. What I want you to do is stone him. Not all stonings were death, but they hurt, and you were severely wounded or broken bones or whatever. And some did wind up in death. And that's the author of life and death is in the Lord's hands. Something I'm all too come to terms with here lately. And so I don't think Moses was saying kill him. If you read this, I think he was saying, here's what we're to do. And the Lord said to Moses, he shall surely die. In other words, I'm going to do this because I have to show my people this is serious, but it's not at your hands. I mean, who threw the blow that killed him? They won't know, because the whole congregation was told to come out here and stone him. Therefore, nobody bears the guilt of the stoning, but they all witnessed the severity of punishment for breaking this commandment. And I guess that's what's so strange to me, is that God was willing many times to kill people who refused to keep his commandments and his statutes. And then all of a sudden, we think he said, oh, well, they're never going to keep them. So, oh, Jesus, go down there and tell them it's okay. Never mind. Really? No. God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He is the same. He's the same God. It bothers me deeply that we come up with these convenient traditions, that man has come up with these convenient lies to keep tradition going. Read the word for yourself. Read it with your pastor, and don't let him just brush you off or you know, blow it over, you know. Truth is truth. Anyway, moving on. Okay, so they took him outside the camp, and then they stoned him, and the man died. And the Lord said, speak unto the children of Israel, and bid them that they make them fringes in the borders of their garments throughout their generations, and that they put them upon the fringe of the border a ribbed band of blue. It shall be unto you a fringe, that ye may look upon it and remember all the commandments of the Lord,
and do them.
And that ye seek not after your own heart and your own eyes, after which ye use to do or to go a whoring. Okay, so he kills this man and says, okay, I see you didn't understand. I meant no work, okay? You should have gathered your kindling for your fire yesterday, not on the Sabbath. So he tells them, make a tzitzi fringe and place it on the corners of your garment, and to put a blue thread on it and wear it all the time. This is on your outer garment, so that you see it and it reminds you daily of all the commandments of God. Now that's awesome. So Monty and I have ordered tzitzis, and we put little carabiners on them so we can clip them on our pants, because we don't wear the kind of four-cornered garments that they had back then. But the spirit of what he was saying to me was, put these on your garments, keep them there as a reminder. Number one, people are going to ask you, what the heck are those things dangling from your pants? Number two, you might be tempted in something in your life that the Lord has told you not to do. And that dangling tzitzi will remind you, this is breaking a commandment of God. Sometimes we need to incorporate tactile things, visual, sensory. And God understood that. He knows us intimately. And he said, okay, people, so put these things on your garments. And he said, for all your generations. He didn't mean just till you guys get it down, because he knew the next generation was going to need it. And the one after that, and the one after that. Because all of us are susceptible to this same sin and sin nature. So, how serious was he about keeping the command? It's real serious. That ye may remember to do all my commandments and be holy unto your God. I am the Lord your God, which brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I am the Lord your God. You're going to say, well, he didn't bring me out of Egypt. Oh, really? Because that's what it felt like to me when I was saved. I was brought out of my Egypt, my place of bondage to sin, to a life that kept me bound to things that I had no business with. So, therefore, he brought me out of Egypt, and I owe him my life, and it is my joy and my honor, my privilege to serve him and to keep his commands. Not all the time now, I'm not perfect. There are times I don't want to keep the commandments, but not all of them, but you know, we struggle at times. But then I'm brought back to that place of, it's a love moment. It's a time of joy. It blesses, truly blesses my family. And trust me, I've had struggles with that. I mean, when you start doing this, you're going to see people will come out of the woodwork, you know. Are you in a cult? No. Are you Jewish now? No. But I love to remind them, our Savior was, remember? We're grafted in to the nation of Israel. How beautiful. And there's so much to that. Moving on. He reiterates it in Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, all five books of the Torah. He deals with the resting on the Sabbath. All five. Okay? What else can we do on Sabbath? We know where to rest. That's clear. Okay? And he meant it. Sing songs. Sing songs and poems unto the Lord. Psalms 92, 1 through 15. A psalm or a song for the Sabbath day. It is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord and to sing praises unto his name. When the wicked spring as the grass, and when all the workers of iniquity do flourish, it is that they shall be destroyed forever. But thou, Lord, art most high forevermore. That's so beautiful. You know, wicked people, sometimes it looks like, God, why are they getting away with all of this? And why are they doing all of this? And, you know, but he's saying, they're going to die. And you and your magnificence and your glory, Lord, will live forever. It will be here forever. How beautiful. For lo, thine enemies, O Lord, for lo, thine enemies shall perish. All the workers of iniquity shall be scattered. But my horn shalt thou exalt like the horn of the unicorn. I shall be anointed with fresh oil, with good oil. Oh, those moments when you just feel the Lord pouring his oil over you. The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree, and he shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. That's me. Even in my old age, as I draw closer and closer to 60, the fruit of the Lord is just alive in me. I learn something every day when I'm obedient to seek and to listen. I've been in a dark place for a while, and it was hard to even want to seek. I was so full and consumed with the pain of losing our daughter. And I found my way back. He never let go of me. I never let go of him. I just was sad. Just so sad. And he reminded me of the joy of life and all the things that I'm blessed with still. That his plans are greater than my plans. That his ways are greater than my ways. We struggle, people. We struggle at times. Nobody's perfect. We're all working out our walk, our salvation. But my heart, my love belongs to the Lord. And even now, there's fruit
And I am so thankful for that, because what a lonely, even more lonely and even more sad place it would be to have lost so much and to only have myself and my husband and nothing greater than us, nothing more. Thank Him. He is mighty. He is wonderful. He is love. And it was so wonderful to spend this Sabbath just reading His word and letting Him anoint me with oil today. So I get this. But anyway, so there we have it. Another thing. We get to rest. And as it says here, sing songs. This is the song of the Sabbath. So churches that say that that you're not supposed to sing in church, wrong. Who should celebrate the Sabbath? This is the biggie, because you hear, and you're going to hear, especially when you decide that you want to do this. You are going to hear from people that love you, and honestly, a lot of them think that they're trying to help you out of something really bad. They're going to say, that was for the Jew. That was for Israel. That was for those people. It doesn't have anything to do with us. That's not true. And here's why. Read Isaiah 56, 2. And this is just one scripture. 2 through, I'm not exactly sure how far it goes, but just start reading it too. Blessed is the man that doeth this, and the son of the man that layeth hold of this, that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it, and keepeth his hand from doing any evil. Neither let the son of the stranger that hath joined himself to the Lord speak, saying, the Lord hath utterly separated me from his people. Neither let the eunuch say, behold, I am a dry tree. So he's saying there are these sects of people, and there are people from other tribes that are going to say, I have no hope because I am not Israel. And the eunuch, I am a dry tree. I can have no offspring. For thus saith the Lord unto the eunuchs that keep my Sabbath and choose the things that please me, not you, but him, and take hold of my covenant. Even unto him will I give in mine house and within my walls a place and a name better than the sons and of daughters. I will give him an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. There are going to be some Jews who have practiced Judaism their whole life, but they did it as a cultural thing, not as a servant to their loving master. And he's saying, I'm going to give that eunuch an everlasting place in my house above my sons and daughters, also the sons of a stranger that join themselves to the Lord, to serve him, and to love the name of the Lord, to be his servants, everyone that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it, and taketh hold of my covenant. Even him will I bring to my holy mountain, and make them joyful in the house of prayer, in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon my altar, for mine house shall be called the house of prayer for all people. How awesome. He knew this was going to come up. Okay, unfortunately, the Jewish people are, you know, like, hey, they're protective. And that's one of the reasons God chose them, because they protected the word all those years for us. But he's saying here, it's not just for you. Anyone, a sojourner meant someone from a faraway land that keeps my Sabbath and doesn't pollute it and accepts my covenant, he is welcome in my house of prayer. So who keeps the Sabbath?
anyone who loves the Lord. All who honor the Sabbath, the Lord, which gathereth the outcasts of Israel, saith, yet will I gather others to him beside those that are gathered unto him now. So he said there's going to be others that are going to come in. It's not just Israel. I'm going to bring people from all over the world. And all of a sudden, people are going to see the truth of this. And they're going to begin to keep the commandments of God again. And to keep his Sabbath. And to make it something special and holy and loving and good. All who honor the Sabbath of Jehovah. So, who's to keep it? Everyone. So we have rest, and he was serious about it. Songs, anyone can keep it with you, as long as they love the Lord. Next thing, turn from your own pleasures on this day. Speak scripture, rest, delight yourself in Jehovah. So here's he's saying, if thou turn thy foot away from the Sabbath, turn thy foot away from the Sabbath means traveling on the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasures on my day, and call the Sabbath a delight. Don't do this as a regulation, as a rule. This is not what this is about. He reads our hearts, not our words and our actions. You can have an ugly heart and bring a tithe to church, and it doesn't mean anything to God. You might as well have kept the money in your wallet, okay? So what he's saying here is, don't do your own things. Do the things that you don't have time for during the week with me. Seek my ways. Speak my words. Listen to music that exalts our relationship and my love for you. Remind yourself of how dear and precious you are to me. Remind yourself that I sent my son to die for you, that I felt you were that important. Keep my commandments and don't look at them as a burden. Let it be the delight of your heart. And if it's not, don't do it, because you're doing it with the wrong heart. This is not binding you back to goose step religion where you just do something because you're supposed to be doing it, because that's what, you know, your preacher told you or whatever. No, this is a relationship, and you are seeking out the things that will please someone you call Lord and your God. And when you do it because you love him and out of love. And remind yourself of how much he loved you. You know, sometimes I think we forget this God of the Old Testament. It was his son that died on the cross. You know, I just lost a daughter. I can't imagine placing her on a cross for someone else. Yet that's what he did for us. He loved us so much that he placed his son, his only son, on a cross because you and I were so precious to him, so important to him. Remind yourself how much he loves you. Isaiah 58:13-14, you can read through there, and it says not to travel, you know, doing your own pleasures, but call the Sabbath a delight. Then shalt thou delight thyself in the Lord, and I will cause thee to ride upon the high places of the earth, and feed thee with the heritage of Jacob thy father, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. Okay, you want to be like the prophets? You want to be endowed with great wisdom and knowledge and love for Jehovah and Yeshua, his son? He's saying, keep the Sabbath. Do the things I've told you to do. Call it a delight in your heart. Sit and visit with me quietly
in a place where we can be alone and intimate together, reminding each other of how much we love each other and how important we are to each other. We forget, just like all married couples go through ebbs and flows in their marriage where, you know, you're just clicking along and then all of a sudden you're like, wow, I really love him. And you always did, but it just wasn't so at the forefront of your mind. He's saying every 7 days, remind yourself how much I love you and how much you love me. Good advice. How long will we keep the Sabbath? Well, here's something interesting. In Isaiah 66:23, they're talking about the future time in the days of the Lord when the millennial kingdom, that's the way some people describe it, and it shall come to pass that from the new moon to another and from one Sabbath to another shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith the Lord. So, when we're living in this millennial kingdom, guess what? We're all going to be keeping Sabbath and festivals. The new moons are the festivals and things that he assigned for us to do. High holy days that he's chosen. Not the ones we've chosen, not the pagan ones, but the ones he set for us to celebrate. We're keeping those in the 1,000-year reign. So, this idea that after Jesus came, that was done away with. So, from the beginning of creation, all the way through to when Jesus came, Sabbath was kept. And God's statutes were established. Okay? Then they're telling us that there's this 2,000-year span now. We don't keep Sabbath anymore. And then once he comes back, then we're going to keep it again. Huh? Really? Do we have to do biblical gymnastics to understand something that was pretty straightforward? It was established at the creation of the planets. And we're going to be doing it at the end. It was always meant to be. He is the same throughout history. So that was kind of interesting. So we'll be keeping it for quite a while. He warns that not only are we to keep it, but our government officials are supposed to keep it. But if you will not hearken unto me and hallow the Sabbath day and not bear a burden or work, even entering into the gates of Jerusalem on the Sabbath day, then will I kindle a fire in the gates thereof, and it shall devour the palaces of Jerusalem, and it shall not be quenched. He's saying, you evil people who I brought out of Egypt, I've given you this wonderful land. You said you wanted a king. Okay, I established kings for you. Now these kings are doing evil on my Sabbath. Jeremiah spent his life telling them, stop this, stop this. They're going to come and destroy you if you don't. Well, the Persians showed up and they were destroyed. Ezekiel, all the prophets, they were sent to warn these kings and these leaders that refused. Sunday is a good day to worship, as is Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Saturday is Sabbath, and it begins Friday night at sunset and ends Saturday at sunset. That is his Sabbath as a gift to you. Okay, so let's look at the New Testament. Did Yeshua keep the Sabbath? Yes, he always did. Matthew, but pray ye that your flight not be in the winter, when he was giving teachings on the end times and what's going to happen in the future. He was saying, now, we're not supposed to work and we're not supposed to travel and stuff on the Sabbath. So pray that this doesn't happen on a Sabbath, or you'll be stuck here in Jerusalem. Now, for somebody who's fixing to do away with this in a few days when he gets crucified, don't you think he should have told him something about it, given him a little hint? But instead, he's telling him, pray it's not on a Sabbath, because you know you can't run
on a Sabbath and pack up and work and do all that stuff. No, pray it's not on a Sabbath, because he kept Sabbath. His Father kept Sabbath. Okay. Matthew 28:1. And in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. Okay, so here we have, there was a high holy Sabbath because this was Passover. They came back the next day after Sabbath to clean the body and prepare it. After they kept regular Sabbath, then they came back Sunday, the first day of the week, and he had risen. Why didn't he arise on the Sabbath? Because he was resting. He was keeping his Father's commandments. He rested on the Sabbath. And he rose on the first day. Okay. Mark 1:21. When they had come to Capernaum, and straightway on the Sabbath day he entered into the synagogue and taught. Okay. Straightway. So immediately, in other words, they got to Capernaum. Sabbath. It's Sabbath. And he said straightway, immediately they went to the synagogue. Okay. They kept Sabbath. Mark 6:2. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many hearing him were astonished, saying, "From whence hath this man these things? And what wisdom is this which he is given unto him?" Well, he's in the temple and he's teaching with such authority, such power. There were no chapters and verses. This was a long story, okay? And you had to be able to manipulate your way through there. And he was able to turn to places in the Torah. The power in his hands. In other words, him knowing. I mean, is he this learned scribe? Isn't this that carpenter's son? Where did he learn all this? He kept Sabbath. As we are here. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as it was his custom, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read, as was his custom. Means this was an established practice that he did. Now, if he's the Messiah and he's come to teach us a new religion, shouldn't he begin now while he's our example? Kept Sabbath because he wanted us to keep Sabbath. He never wanted us to forsake it. It's wrong to teach people to do that. The apostles are teaching in the synagogue and are teaching about the truths of Yeshua fulfilling the prophecies of old. Now the Gentiles heard about this. This is in Acts 13. The Gentiles heard about these words and wanted them to teach them on the next Sabbath. So, not just the Jews, but the Gentiles said, "Next Sabbath, will you come and teach us about all of this stuff? Because we heard this great thing you're teaching." Why didn't Paul tell them, "Well, no, I can come tomorrow because we're establishing a new Sabbath." Or, no, I'll come next Sunday on the first day of the week. Because I haven't told the Jews yet, but we're going to start a new Sabbath. No, everybody knew what Sabbath was. Even the Gentiles knew what Sabbath was. Sabbath was the day of rest. Sabbath was God's day. It was established by him. And they wanted him to come and teach them on that Sabbath. These Jewish people that he was sitting there in the synagogue teaching didn't want, the people were amazed, but not the leaders, the Jewish leaders. So the Gentiles said, "Come to our churches on the next Sabbath and teach us." And he did. And almost the entire town showed up. That means Jew and Gentile to hear his teaching. And the Jews saw the crowd that came and were jealous and envious and realized our livelihood here is at stake. Okay. And to me, this is the creme de la creme. Okay. In Hebrews 4, verses 8 through 11, I think it is. There remains, therefore, a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For he who enters into his rest has himself also rested from his works, as God did from his. So let us therefore give diligence to enter into that rest, lest anyone fall after the same example of disobedience. Okay, there it is in a nutshell. Hebrews is telling us there's an established Sabbath. Let us seek diligently, okay, to keep the Sabbath, lest we cause others to fall into disobedience. I think if they were going to form a new faith on a new day, this would have been a good time to mention it. Yeshua has already died. He's gone to heaven. They're teaching how this faith that they've learned is to open the eyes of the people. I think it's time they should start talking about this new Sabbath thing, but they don't, because they all keep the Sabbath. It was the Catholic Church that changed it. So on your Sabbath, if you're going to keep it, look at some of the traditions that some of the Hebrews and Jews and the nation of Israel do, because some of them are beautiful. Some of them might bless you, but none of them are commanded. Just remember that. My husband and I, every Sabbath, we blow the shofar, establishing in our home, this begins Sabbath. That works for us. We like it. We enjoy it. It's a way of separating the common or the everyday from the holy day. So when sunset falls and Sabbath begins, we blow the shofar. It's just a nice little reminder. But it's not a commandment. You don't have to do that. We have the Lord's Supper every Sabbath. That's how we begin our Sabbath, is we sit down and we have wine, and we use real wine. And we have bread that we baked, and we do a lot of beautiful things and teachings through our Sabbath. These are great things to learn. They're enhancing to us. They are focused on Yeshua and Jehovah, but they are not commanded. This is just a way we found to do Sabbath. Now, the next video that I'm going to make is showing how we do Sabbath and how it's a very quick thing. It takes about 15 minutes to establish our tradition for Sabbath. And then from that point on until the end of Sabbath, we spend our time in God things, God music, God documentaries or movies, scripture, prayer, things that edify our relationship with Him. That's the rule. Rest. You can sing, you can read poetry of Him, read scripture, meditate, pray, have time with your kids, do a Bible study, just have quality time. Not doing the things you want to do, but keeping it holy for Him. It's such a blessing. It's a joy to prepare when you know you're making your food because it's going to be Sabbath and you're making extra so you don't have to cook. And you're setting out your silver, because we bought you know, special dishes that we use only that day to set it apart. That works for us. You don't have to do that. That's the biggest thing, I guess, I wanted to say is don't get bogged down in these legalistic things that people put out there as their own traditions. It's okay to have traditions. Traditions are a way of protecting that which is sacred and keeping it sacred for you. But don't confuse tradition with commandments. Commandments come from the Father and from the Son. Traditions are just beautiful things that are added to our life, and some not so beautiful, some maybe burdensome. Don't fall for that. There's a lot of Hebrew roots movements out there. They have great information, but some of them are dogmatic about things they need not be. And they're falling into their own faults, traps. But it's okay, because we're all new to Torah. We're all trying to work this out. We're all trying to figure out how to do this. And it's going to work. And we're going to spark something in the Jewish people that reminds them of how much they love Yehovah. And it's going to prick them to jealousy. And they're going to come back to their faith. So the next time, we're going to do a Shabbat. Until then, Shabbat Shalom.